Section 32, read with the income tax rules, gives you the rates of depreciation. The most important rates are building, normal building. I'm not talking about special buildings and temporary structures and all that. 10%. Then furniture, including electrical fittings, is also 10%. Then you have intangibles, which is 25%, and you have plant, which has multiple rates, also useful for exams. So what are the different rates for plant? General plant and machinery is 15%. Then specific plant and machinery, for example motor car, is also 15%. But if the motor car is used for hiring or transport business, then the 15% becomes 30%. Then you have books. The rate of books is 40%. Earlier it used to be 60 and 100. And you have computers. Computers rate is also 40%. So the change last year was that all the rates more than 40% would be brought down to 40%. So you had like books which were 60 and 100, computers which were 60. Everything has now been brought down to 40. So there is no rate of depreciation which is in excess of 40%. Okay, so these are the most important rates that will come in most problems. And when you are doing computers, you should keep in mind that this will include printers and softwares which are inbuilt, which cannot be independently used, things like that. And it does not include EPABX, that is nothing but the hardware of your internal telephones in your office. So for example, someone calls your office, so it gets routed to the correct department. So you have some hardware for that. That is not a computer. So you have like an IVR, voice recognition, and automated systems of tracking phone calls, etc., and redirecting phone calls. Those will be considered as EPABX. They will not be considered as computer. So if you have EPABX, it will come under your general plant and machinery. So these are the most important rates of depreciation for the purposes of Income Tax Act. There are other rates as well. And in income tax, you have to follow WDV method. That means you have to follow the block of assets concept. Only a power sector SSE has the choice of WDV or SLM. No other SSE has the choice. Apart from this rates what we discussed is known as normal depreciation. Apart from this, you have something known as enhanced or additional depreciation, which is also as per Section 32. The enhanced depreciation rate is 20%. And if the SSE is located in the notified backward area of four states, what are those four states? Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, West Bengal, Bihar. In these four states, not anywhere, it should be a notified backward area. You need to check the notification whether that area where your industry is has a notification regarding that. If it's not notified, then just because you're located in that state does not make you eligible for a higher rate of enhanced. So if you're located in these four states notified backward area, the 20% jumps to 35%. 20% jumps to 35%. What are the conditions for enhanced? The conditions for enhanced are that no second hand, no office appliance, no computers, no road transport vehicles, and therefore in a way it is applicable only to plant and machinery, first of all, enhanced depreciation, and you should be a manufacturer. So if you look at the overall intent and the words, it looks like only plant and machinery which are installed in the factory will get covered by enhanced depreciation. Similarly for the notified backward areas, it's just that instead of 20 it will become 35 for them, just the rate difference. For example, if I am located in Karnataka and I'm a manufacturer, I bought plant and machinery, original cost is 100, the depreciation I will get is 15 plus 20, I will get a total depreciation of 35. If I'm located in Andhra Pradesh notified backward area, I buy the same asset, I'm a manufacturer, install it in the factory, I can get 15 plus 35. So I will get a total depreciation of 50. Is this a benefit? It is a benefit, but it's not extra benefit. Because remember, the Karnataka SSE, next year when he tries to take the depreciation, his WDV will be 65. And the Andhra Pradesh SSE WDV will be 50. So in the second year, Karnataka SSE will get 65 into 15%, and Andhra Pradesh SSE will get 50 into 15%. So the second year depreciation will get reversed. This is known as reversal of timing difference in deferred tax. Same concept, it will get reversed. So the Andhra Pradesh SSE will get higher depreciation in the first year, which will eventually result in lower depreciation in subsequent years. It's like he raced ahead. But yes, slowly he will fall back. The Karnataka SSE will start going ahead. After a while, ultimately depreciation, remember, reduces the cost to zero. Depreciation does not give you more than 100 rupees in this case. So it is not like extra benefit. And if the asset is put to use for less than 180 days, then the depreciation will be half of the rates. So if you are eligible for 15 plus 20, you will get 7.5 plus 10, you will get 17.5. If you are eligible for 15 plus 35, you will get 7.5 plus 17.5. So you will get 25%. So effectively the half rates will be given, even for enhanced. If it's more than equal to 180 days, you will get whatever we have discussed. The rates we have mentioned are all full rates. There was a small amendment to this 2 years back. So if you see an SSE who buys the asset in the second half of the year, normal depreciation, no issues, you get every year. So an SSE who buys an asset in the second half of the year will get half rate of normal depreciation, half rate of enhanced depreciation, right? So just take the example of an SSE who buys it on put to use, let's say on 1/1/2018, that is PY17/18, in the second half of the year. That means definitely it is less than equal to 180 days, right? So now this guy, the original cost assume is 100, he will get a normal depreciation of 7.5, and assuming enhanced is eligible for him, he will get enhanced of 10, normal SSE. I'm not talking about a notified backward area of 4 states SSE. So if you notice, normal depreciation also he gets half, enhanced also he gets half. Normal depreciation half is okay because next year also he'll get normal. So if you just consider the normal depreciation, his WDV will be about 92.5. So he will get a higher depreciation next year because his WDV has not reduced by 15%. But the enhanced, he will get it only in the first year, in the year of installation. So it results in a slightly unfair situation for a guy who adds it in the second half of the year. He will never get the remaining 10%. he will get it in the form of normal depreciation higher, but he will never get it in the this year or in the next year. But the same guy, let's say, had added it in the first half, he would have got 15, 20. So just compare the enhanced depreciations. The enhanced depreciation for the second guy will be full. The first case, it will be half. And you will never ever give that other half normally, right? Because enhanced depreciation is given only in year one. So there was an amendment which said that if you've taken half of enhanced, you can get the balance half in the next previous year. If you have taken half, you get the next half. So if you see, both these SSCs are on par. Both of them have got 20% enhanced. One guy has got in 2 years 10 and 10, one more guy has got 20%. So there was a recent amendment in depreciation provisions, not in section 32, in explanation to section 43. So one of the definitions is the definition of actual cost. So the definition of actual cost has been modified. Actual cost means the amount paid minus any subsidy plus any taxes plus any interest till it is put to use as per the relevant ICDS read with 3613. So if you add all of this and subtract the subsidy, you will get your actual cost. And what is the significance of actual cost? This is the one which is added to the block. So if there is actual cost, your block goes up. Block goes up, you get depreciation. Now, let's say, for example, there was a purchase of building, and the building was purchased for 10 lakhs and it was paid in the form of cash. What will you do? Will you disallow it under section 48.3? Will you disallow the purchase of this building under 48.3? You will not disallow it under 48.3. 48.3 looks like it's violated, but it's not. Because if you see the words of 48.3, it says expenditure will be disallowed. Expenditure disallowed means it should be allowed. Am I taking building into the P&L account and taking it as an expense? No. If I'm not taking building into P&L account, taking it as an expense, there is no question of disallowing the expense. So in a way, 48.3, although it does not state it explicitly, does not or cannot disallow capital expenses, because capital expenses is not a allowed expense under 3237. What is allowed is the depreciation, and 48.3 does not ask you to add back the depreciation in respect of that. It says expenditure incurred towards that purpose. And here I have spent 10 lakhs, but 10 lakh will not be disallowed because I never took a deduction of 10 lakhs. So in a way, 48.3 was rendered useless in this case of a capital expenditure. So you could do whatever you want when you do a capital expenditure and not have a problem with 48.3. Remember, other penalty provisions obviously could apply, but we are only discussing business and profession impact now. So no disallowance under 48.3. Now what do they do? So many years, imagine, so many years it took them to figure out, okay, what should I do? They were like, finally they woke up. Like, people are claiming this, now let me put an end to this. So they did not amend 48.3. They amended the definition of actual cost, and they said that if this amount paid exceeds 10,000 on a single day to the same person, very similar to 48.3, almost the same, the difference is it will not be added to actual cost. And also the fact that it should be in three modes. If otherwise, if you don't do it in these three modes. Three modes are what? Account paycheck, account pay draft, ECS. So if you do any other payment, cash, cross check, cross DD, and you pay more than 10,000, it will not be added to block. Not added to block means no depreciation. No depreciation means in a way it is being disallowed, and you'll never get. Not just this year, next year also you'll never get. So in a way, capital expenditure disallowance, revenue expenditure disallowance are now both covered by this amendment. Clear with this? Now for example, let's say in this 10 lakh, so I buy a building and the building cost is 10 lakh. Now 6 lakh is by cash and 4 lakh is by account paycheck. Now should I not add 10 or can I add 4? Is it partial or full? Yes, I can still consider 4. That part of the expenditure which is okay, I can still consider. Again, to be read like 48. 48 also, to that extent of violation, I will not consider or I'll add back. Balance I can always take. Same logic will be applied. But there can be a loophole in this provision. There are a couple of loopholes in this provision. Again, when they framed it, they probably did not think about the impact of those loopholes. Two loopholes. One loophole is if you split the payments. Okay, so if I'm buying an asset of 10 lakh, I split 10,000 every day for 100 days. But remember, ₹269 SS or ST will still come. May still come depending on how much is the amount. If it's 10 lakh, yes, definitely. 269 SS is 20,000. 269 ST is 2 lakh. From the same transaction also, even splitting will not save me there. 48.3 actual cost definition, I can split and I can avoid it. But SS and ST, I cannot split and avoid it. So it will still get attracted. So this is one loophole. The second one is, again, this should be addressed ideally. 48.3 has a clause which says that if you have claimed something on accrual basis in a PY, so there is no way to check the payment, right? When you do it on accrual basis, you've not yet paid, so it won't violate 48.3. Now, in a subsequent PY, pay more than 10,000 otherwise than by way of the three modes, then the amount will be added to income. It'll get retaxed. You took deduction, it gets retaxed. There is no such provision in this amendment to depreciation read with actual cost. So if I claim something on accrual basis, it will get added to block. Now, I pay it in cash. Now I have to remove it from block. Removing from block is not possible unless there is a sale of the asset. So this provision is not there. Similar provision is not there. So on 31st March, add, don't pay. 1st April, pay. So I could exploit these two loopholes and still get away with it.